Someone once said that if you got all the speakers in the world and laid them end to end, you ought to just leave them that way. And I hope you won't feel that way when I finish. It is a high honor and a personal privilege to speak at the George Mason commencement. I have watched George Mason grow into one of the leading universities in the country. I want to congratulate the students and their family members. And if I can say a special word to Jack Zerwinski, who works in my office, has been with me for many, many years. Jack, congratulations. I don't remember who spoke at my graduation at Penn State in 1961, and I do not remember what was said, so I want to say some things that I hope you will remember. And in speaking today, I'm really speaking to myself because it helps me to hold myself accountable. Family and character. The importance of family. I had wanted to be in Congress since I was in third grade at elementary school back in Philadelphia. I stuttered badly, I still stutter sometimes, and many in my class would laugh at me and say, "How can you run for office? You really can't even speak before our class." I left a safe job to run for office. I ran for 5 years. I ran in 1976 and lost. Ran again in 1978 and lost again. And then ran in 1980 and barely won. I grabbed President Reagan's coattails and he pulled me across the line. Sometimes I would be out campaigning at subway stops and supermarkets and people would say, "Are you running again?" And it would almost hurt to hear that, but I was persistent. Wherever two or three were gathered, I was there. I worked very hard. I was driven. While running for office, I missed Little League games. My wife and I, we have five children and 16 grandkids. I missed vacations. I missed PTA meetings. I missed most family events. I thought it would improve after I got elected, but it didn't. It actually got worse. There was always an event to go to. Then two congressmen, Dan Coats, a Republican from Indiana who's now a United States Senator, and Wes Watkins, a Democrat from Oklahoma, asked me to come see a film. The film was entitled "Where's Dad?" I was the only member of the House that came to the showing. It was on a big reel for like an old Army training film. When I was in the Army, I had these large reel films, which probably many of you or most of you have never seen. It started very slow. I was almost getting ready to leave. And then Harry Chapin's song, "Cats in a Cradle," was read. Here's what it says. "My child arrived just the other day. He came to the world in the usual way, but there were planes to catch and bills to pay. He learned to walk while I was away, and he was talking before I knew it, and as he grew, he'd say, 'I'm going to be like you, Dad. You know, I'm going to be just like you.' And the cats in the cradle and the silver spoon, the little boy blue and the man in the moon. When are you coming home, Dad? I don't know when, but we'll get together then, son. You know, we'll have a good time then. My son turned 10 just the other day. He said, 'Thanks for the ball, Dad. Come on, let's play. Can you teach me to throw?' I said, 'Not today. I've got a lot to do.' He said, 'That's okay.' And as he walked away, but his smile never dimmed, and said, 'I'm going to be like him. You know, I'm going to be just like him.' and the Cat's in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon, the Little Boy Blue and the Man in the Moon. When he coming home, Dad? I don't know when, but we'll get together then, son. You know, we'll have a good time then. Well, he came home from college just the other day, so much like a man, I had to say, son, I'm proud of you. Can you sit for a while? He shook his head and said with a smile, what I really like, Dad, is the bar of the car keys. See you later. Can I have them, please? And the Cat's in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon, the Little Boy Blue and the Man in the Moon. When he coming home, son? I don't know when, but we'll get together then, Dad. You know, we'll have a good time then. I've long since retired. My son's moved away. I called him up just the other day. I said, I'd like to see you if you don't mind. He said, I'd love to, Dad, if I can find the time. You see, my new job's a hassle and the kids have the flu, but it's sure nice talking to you, Dad. It's sure nice talking to you. As I hung up the phone, it occurred to me, he'd grown up to be just like me. My boy was just like me. And the Cat's in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon, the Little Boy Blue and the Man in the Moon. When he coming home, son? I don't know when. We'll get together then, Dad. You know, we're going to have a good time then. I wept when I heard those words. After that, I changed my life in so many ways. I attend every family event. I have never missed a vacation since I have seen that film. I stopped going to political events on Sundays 32 years ago. If Ronald Reagan and George Bush and Clinton came to the end of my street for an event, I would not have gone. I put my family, my wife, my children, my grandchildren first. I have often wondered what my life and my family would have been like had I not seen the film. Senator Paul Tsongas, whose wife serves with me in the House of Massachusetts, who has since died, tells the story how he left the Senate to spend more time with his family. He said he went to Great Falls Park, which is in my congressional district, went out on the rocks and looked back at his two daughters and made the decision to leave so he could spend more time with his family. Senator Tsongas said, quote, I never heard anyone on their deathbed say, I wish I had spent more time with my business. They always wish they had spent more time with their families. You can't put this off. There is the rapid passage of time. Psalm 9, verse 10 says, the length of our days is 70 years or 80, if we have the strength. Yet their span is but trouble and sorrow, for they pass quickly and we fly away. In Psalm 103:15, King David said, as for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like the flower in the field. The wind blows over it and it is gone, and its place is no more. So remember your family, your father, your mother, your brothers, your sisters. When I see my five kids together and my grandkids together, loving each other, remember your grandmoms, your grandpops. And if you have a family, your husband, your wife, your children. So the first message is not really great, not big theological messages, but family, family, family. The next point is character. Noted author Stephen Covey, who has written a number of self-help books, has observed that in the first 150 years of our country, character, integrity, courage were the things we measured a person by. Think of George Washington, our first president, whose first elective office was from my congressional district in Winchester, Virginia. When you think of Washington, you think of honesty, you think of integrity, you think of courage, you think of faithfulness, you think of virtue. You know, that's a word. When's the last time you heard anyone talk about virtue? Virtue. In the last 50 years, Covey said, our measure of a person is personality traits. Is he or she a good communicator? Is he a nice guy? Do they have style? Do they have a nice smile? So what kind of men and women should we, you and me together, strive to be? Isaiah chapter 1, verse 17 says, learn to do right, seek justice. All through the Bible, justice, justice, justice. Encourage the oppressed, defend the cause of the fatherless, and plead the case of the widow. Micah chapter 6, verse 8 said, he has showed you what is good, and what does the Lord require, not expect, but require of you to act justly, to have mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So I challenge you, and I challenge myself today, to follow these guidelines, to be a person who fears God, to be trustworthy, to be a person of integrity, of character. We should ask ourselves, do I want to be a person of excellence or a person of expedience? Do I want to be a person of principle or one who seeks to be popular? Do I want to be a person who looks for the right thing to do and does it, or the one who finds the easy way around whatever I'm facing? So don't be afraid to take on the tough issues. And if you are, still take them on. As I said earlier, I've had a stuttering problem. I thank God for stuttering. I probably would not have been in Congress had I not stuttered. Sometimes the thing we most fear can really be a good thing. In the winter edition of the Stuttering Foundation newsletter, there's an article about a graduation speech by Susanna Parkin of Hamilton College. Susanna makes the point in the speech about fear. She says, quote, it is important to do things in spite of fear. We know this to be true. And then she goes on to make another very important point. She said, my second message is a slight revision of the first. I believe that we should do things in spite of our fear, but I also believe that sometimes we have to go even further. She said, we have to do things because we are afraid. We have to see a situation, recognize our fear, and do it because it scares us. I used to hate to be called on and was fearful, and my palms would sweat, and I was frightened that they would call me. But do you force yourself? You force yourself to get up and speak if you stutter or you have something like that. We have to see fear as an opportunity for growth. We have to seek out challenges. Facing our fear with a sense of purpose makes us stronger because it puts us in control of our fear. Bobby Kennedy, brother of President John F. Kennedy, spoke before a group of students in South Africa in June of 1966. He said the following. He said, a third danger is timidity. Few men or women are willing to brave the disapproval of their fellows, the censure of their colleagues, the wrath of their society. He said, moral courage is a rarer commodity than bravery in battle or great intelligence. Yet moral courage is the one essential vital quality of those who seek to change the world, which yields most painfully to change. So remember, family, can't put it off. Rapid passage of time, character, faith, and moral courage. I want to leave you with a quote as I end by Dr. James Dobson that I have hanging in my office and on my family room wall. It says the following. I have concluded that the accumulation of wealth even if I could achieve it, is an insufficient reason for living. When I reach the end of my days, a moment or two from now, I must look backward on something more meaningful than the pursuit of houses and land and machines and stocks and bonds. Nor is fame of any lasting benefit. I will consider my earthly existence to have been wasted, unless I can recall a loving family, a consistent investment in the lives of other people, helping other people, and an earnest attempt to serve the God who made me, and nothing else makes much sense. I pray that you will be a driving force to strengthen the American family, be men and women of honesty, integrity, and character. So my question to all of you who are getting a degree today, at the end of your life, when it's all been said and done, will you have lived for what really matters? God bless you, and I wish you the best.